Well, church, we continue on a series. We started on the book of Acts, and right now we're at Acts chapter 17. Let's see if I can get this to work. Oh, it's already up there. Okay. We're at Acts chapter 17, and we want to read this passage first. We're going to read half the chapter. Okay, we spare you. We'll read half the chapter from verses 16 to 34. All right, so would we please stand together and we will read it aloud together with the congregation, Acts chapter 17, verses 16 to 34. Are you ready? On the count of three. One, two, three. While Paul was waiting for them in Athens, he was greatly distressed to see that the city was full of idols. So he reasoned in the synagogue with both Jews and God-fearing Greeks, as well as in the marketplace day by day with those who happened to be there. A group of Epicurean and Stoic philosophers began to debate with him. Some of them asked, "What is this babbler trying to say?" Others remarked, "He seems to be advocating foreign gods." They said this because Paul was preaching the good news about Jesus and the resurrection. Then they took him and brought him to a meeting of the Areopagus, where they said to him, "May we know what this new teaching is that you are presenting? You are bringing some strange ideas to our ears, and we would like to know what they mean. Now, all the Athenians and the foreigners who live there spend their time doing nothing but talking about and listening to the latest ideas." Paul then stood up in the meeting of the Areopagus and said, "People of Athens, I see that in every way you are very religious. For as I walked around and looked carefully at your objects of worship, I even found an altar with this inscription, 'To an unknown God.' So you are ignorant of the very thing you worship. And this is what I'm going to proclaim to you. The God who made the world and everything in it is the Lord of heaven and earth and does not live in temples built by human hands. And he is not served by human hands as if he needed anything. Rather, he himself gives everyone life and breath and everything else. From one man he made all the nations that they should inhabit the whole earth. And he marked out their appointed times in history and the boundaries of their lands. God did this so that they would seek him and perhaps reach out for him and find him, though he is not far from any one of us. For in him we live and move and have our being. As some of your own prophets have said, we are his offspring. Therefore, since we are God's offspring, we should not think that the divine being is like gold or silver or stone, an image made by human design and skill. In the past, God overlooked such ignorance, but now he commands all people everywhere to repent. For he has set a day when he will judge the world with justice by the man he has appointed. He has given proof of this to everyone by raising him from the dead." When they heard about the resurrection of the dead, some of them sneered. Oops. But others said, "We want to hear you again on this subject." At that, Paul left the council. Some of the people became followers of Paul and believed. Among them was Dionysius, a member of the Areopagus, also a woman named Damaris, and a number of others. Shall we pray? Our gracious Heavenly Father, we give thanks to you for the access that we have to your word. We thank you for the privilege that we have to be able to gather like this every week. And it is our freedom in this country. And we thank you that we can do so in security. We thank you, Lord. And this morning, as we come and consider your word, Father, we open our hearts and our minds to you. May your Holy Spirit speak to us and convict us and grant us grace that we might not only hear, but that we might also obey. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Please be seated. Well, this message is entitled "Mystery Revealed to All." Now, perhaps the word mystery is a mystery itself to you at this point. But actually, in the writings of Paul, it's not really a mystery at all. In a sense, he makes it pretty clear what he is talking about. For example, in Ephesians chapter 3, verse 6, he tells us that this mystery is that through the gospel, the Gentiles are heirs together with Israel, members together of one body, and sharers together in the promise in Christ Jesus. He basically is saying that this mystery is the gospel of Jesus Christ, which is good for Jews and Gentiles. He affirms that again in chapter 6, verse 19 of Ephesians, when he says, to pray also for me, that whenever I speak, words may be given to me, that I will fearlessly make known the mystery of the gospel. So when I entitled the message, Mystery Revealed to All, I could easily retitle it simply as The Gospel for All. It is the gospel of Jesus Christ for all humanity. It was a mystery kept hidden until Jesus came. And when Jesus came, he was revealed and through Paul made plain to all that the gospel of Jesus Christ, that salvation is for all humanity through Christ. Let me perhaps recap to you where we have come to at this point in the book of Acts. You know, the book of Acts is sometimes called the Acts of the Apostles, but in reality, it really is really a few acts of a few apostles. Not all the apostles are mentioned, and not all of their accounts are told. The book of Acts is largely the account of the acts of Peter and Paul. These are the two main characters in the book of Acts. And to some extent, it is perhaps more than half the book is really about Paul's journeys and his missionary efforts. So we, at this point in chapter 17, it's clearly about Paul. But it was becoming about Paul and his story from chapter 13 onwards. And when the story focuses on Paul, the story is decidedly about the advance of the gospel beyond Jerusalem, beyond Judea, beyond Samaria, to the ends of the earth. And we read about Paul's first missionary journey, when at the end of his missionary journey, there were churches that were planted, communities of Christians that were planted in Greek cities, pagan cities. And when they'd come back to Jerusalem, after a little while, Paul decided he'd want to revisit the churches that had been planted. But at that point, there was a disagreement between Paul and Barnabas as to who should go with them. Barnabas wanted John Mark to join the team, but Paul didn't think that was a good idea because John Mark had left the team on the first missionary trip. So there was a sharp disagreement between the two of them, to the point that in the end, there were two teams. There was a team with Barnabas and John Mark, and another team with Paul and Silas. Two missionary teams instead. And if you recall, Pastor Daniel spoke of this sharp disagreement and noted how towards the end of his life, Paul recognized the contribution of that young man who had disappointed him on his first missionary journey. And how Pastor Daniel reminded us that we should not write people off when they fail us, because the Holy Spirit is still working in their lives. Now, on his second missionary journey, Paul and Silas is joined by Timothy and Luke. And at one point, they were wanting to go into this place and the Holy Spirit kept them. It's very clear in the text of the book of Acts that the Holy Spirit kept them going into Bithynia and Mysia. And one night, Paul had a vision where a man from Macedonia was calling to him, come to us. So prompted by that vision, Paul and his missionary team went to Macedonia. And at Philippi, one of the main cities of Macedonia, their preaching caused a riot. A riot which saw Paul and Silas thrown into prison, thrown into jail because of the riots which was attributed to them. And while Paul and Silas were worshiping God in the middle of the night, singing their hymns and psalms heartily, there was an earthquake that shook the prison, that shook the jail, that threw all the doors open. And last week, I think that Pastor Alex reminded us of the power of praise under adverse circumstances. He called it prison praise. I think that's a great phrase. And the power of prison praise, that in spite of extreme adverse circumstances, a view of God that causes us to worship and praise God in spite of everything can be deeply transformative. And in that situation in the book of Acts, where Paul and Silas sang till there was an earthquake, so to speak, A jailer and his family came to faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. And the story continues that in the morning, the magistrates wanted to set Paul and Silas free. After some face-saving measures, Paul and Silas agreed to leave. And they left Philippi. And from there, we pick up the story in Acts chapter 17. You know, our societies these days have become increasingly diverse. I'm sure some of you, like myself, over 50, when I was growing up, when I went to Kuala Lumpur, when I went to the city was populated by Malays, Chinese, Indians. Everywhere you see orang Cina, budak Melayu, sini, an Indian boy, an Indian guy. Even in Sungai Wang Plaza, which was like the hottest shopping mall at that time, when I was a kid. To see an Ang Mo, that was like, whoa. Wow, this is a rare specimen, examining from head to toe. I've never seen one with blonde hair before. You know, it's rare. But these days, on Tuesday, if you go to the city, well, I don't know what you will find, but you'll find Ang Mo la, you will find dark-skinned people from Bangladesh, you'll find people. Our society is changing. I remember when I was a student in Melbourne, I was the odd one out. You know, going down to the cash register at the Coles supermarket, you know, when the cashier lady says, "Good day, love." It's like, I'm the only one with black hair around. But these days, if you go down to Melbourne, in the central business district, if you're white, you'll be the odd one out. The city has changed. The demographics have changed. The compositions have changed. And that's simply because the mobility that is granted by travel, you know, as Asia says, everyone can fly now. So people are going everywhere. People are moving. People take jobs in faraway countries. And all our cities around the world, our major cities, are all changing. Multiculturalism, diversity. These are the words that you hear today very much. And these are things we are told to celebrate. I think we should celebrate because learning from other people's cultures enriches all of us. But I think a very important question is, what does it mean for the Church of Jesus Christ? We can talk about multiculturalism in our societies, but what does it mean for the Church? What does it mean for a church like ours in a society like ours? A society like ours is multicultural, multi-ethnic, multi-religious. What does it mean for a congregation like ours, which is largely, I'd say, middle class, middle income, white collar, largely professional, largely, I would say, Western educated? What does it mean for our congregation here in DUMC that our society around us is increasingly diverse? That we will have people coming from different cultural backgrounds, different religious backgrounds, just different. What does it mean for the church? And what does it mean to our mandate to bring the gospel to the ends of the earth? What does it mean for the church? I'd like to share with you my big idea first. And the big idea is simply this, that the gospel of Christ is for all humanity to hear. The gospel of Jesus Christ is for all humanity to hear. Therefore, we need to communicate the gospel so that it can get a fair hearing. Did you get that? We need to communicate the gospel so that it can get a fair hearing. Let me just outline to you very briefly how my message will go. Three parts. First, I'll talk about the crowds of people that Paul encountered in chapter 17. And perhaps what similarities there might be to the kinds of people we might encounter. Secondly, what was the communication posture that Paul took in approaching these people that he was trying to communicate with? And thirdly, what was the Christ that he presented to these people? the crowds of people, the communication posture, and the Christ presented. So let me first begin with the crowds of people. You know, Paul sought to communicate to different kinds of people. Perhaps if you at least in the book of Acts, okay, we can't really say about the other apostles, of which we know very little from the book of Acts. But definitely with Paul, we find that he's probably the most versatile of all the apostles in communicating and preaching to his world, his Jewish world as well as the Gentile world. And he sought to communicate to people with different backgrounds and different cultures. That's why he is called the apostle to the Gentiles. And Gentile, by the way, is not one block of people. Yeah, it's Gentile is basically anyone who is not a Jew, non-Jewish. And all of us, I think like Pastor Daniel reminded us, any Jew here? Just in case. All of us are Gentiles, whether you are Chinese, Indian, of any other race, you're a foreigner from some other country, we are all Gentiles unless you are a Jew. So being a Gentile is really, that group is very, very diverse. And Paul sought to communicate to Gentiles. And the first group of people we read about in Acts chapter 17 are the Thessalonians. In particular, the Thessalonian Jews. Now it tells us that when Paul arrived at Thessalonica, as was his custom, he would go to the synagogue. He would always preach in the synagogue first. He would preach the Jews and the Gentiles who would be there. Now, some Gentiles would be at the synagogue, okay, as God-fearing Gentiles. Okay, they have not quite become Jews yet. They have not quite adopted all of Judaism yet. They have not yet been circumcised, but they like what they hear and they're there to be a part of it slowly before they decide whether they want to be a Jew or not. And it tells us that in verse 3, that as he preached, he says, some of the Jews were persuaded and joined Paul and Silas. So Paul and Silas did have some result in Thessalonica. But it says some of the Jews were persuaded and joined Paul and Silas, as did a large number of God-fearing Greeks and quite a few prominent women. So that tells me, at least in that context, a lot of the people who followed Paul and Silas and accepted what they were preaching were largely Gentiles. But there were a few of the Jews. But it also tells us, and Luke makes this is how Luke characterizes the people at Thessalonica, the Jews at Thessalonica. But it says, but other Jews were jealous. Now it's possible that they were jealous because Paul and Silas were drawing away many of these God-fearing Greeks. Now these God-fearing Greeks, you might say, were candidates to become Jews, to become proselytes, converts to Judaism. And suddenly Paul is taking away a chunk of this proselyte class. You know, it's like our membership class. Suddenly, three-quarters of the membership class have gone somewhere else. Hey, what's going on? And these Jews were jealous. And in their jealousy, what did they do? The text tells us that they rounded up some bad characters from the marketplace and formed a mob and started a riot. Some bad characters. Now, some other translations say, a bunch of brawlers, unprincipled loungers, and one translator puts it, just basically bums. Some bums from the marketplace. They formed a mob and they started a riot. Maybe they wore the same color t-shirt, I don't know, okay? But they created a riot and they wanted to grab Paul and Silas. And they kind of figured out that he lived in this place, and they went there. Paul and Silas weren't there for whatever reason. And instead, they took the host. So they were quite upset. They were quite upset with Paul and Silas and the preaching that Paul brought. In fact, they were so upset and so hostile to Paul and Silas that when Paul and Silas left Thessalonica and went to the next city, when these guys had heard, hey, Paul and Silas have gone to the next city, they went to that next city to do the same thing, because in Acts chapter 17, verse 13, it says, when the Jews in Thessalonica learned that Paul was preaching the word of God at Berea, the next city, some of them went there too, agitating the crowds and stirring them up. Same thing. So these Thessalonian Jews were quite hostile. They largely refused to consider Paul's preaching or to reconsider a reinterpretation of the scriptures based on what Paul was saying. They just outrightly refused to consider. You know, in church history, gospel truth, the restoration of gospel truth, was always resisted first by the establishment of the church. When Luther came on the scene and he understood that salvation is by grace through faith, he was rejected by the church of his day. When John Wesley preached his messages, he was rejected by the church of his day, of which he was an ordained minister. When the charismatic Pentecostal movement was birthed at the beginning of the 20th century, the established church rejected. And basically, that's how the Pentecostal church started, because the established church refused to consider whether such a thing was biblical. And may we not be a Thessalonian church, that when we hear anything from this pulpit, may we always consider whether it is biblical or not. Well, let's come to the Bereans then. The Bereans are the next group of Jews mentioned in Acts chapter 17. And it tells us that when Paul went to Berea, he did exactly the same thing. He went to the Jewish synagogue, and there he preached. But Luke describes the Bereans somewhat differently from the Thessalonian Jews, because he says, now the Berean Jews were of more noble character than those in Thessalonica. Why did he describe them as more noble in character? Because they received the message with great eagerness and examined the scriptures every day to see if what Paul said was true. They heard Paul, they heard him preach, and they asked the question, interesting. I wonder if what he's saying is true or correct. And it just tells us there in the text that they examined the scriptures every day to see if what he was saying was true. A completely different attitude, at least characterized by Luke's writing, completely different from the Thessalonian Jews. There they refused to entertain Paul and to consider a reinterpretation of scripture, to consider that this Jesus Christ of Nazareth might be the Messiah. But the Berean Jews, listening to Paul, said, I wonder whether there's any validity in what he's saying. And they went back home, or they stayed back in the synagogue, I don't know. But it says that they examined the scriptures every day to see if that was true. And what is the result? Luke writes it this way: as a result, what does it say there? Some? Many. It says, as a result, many of them, Jews, believed, as did a number of prominent Greek women and many Greek men. And here the result of Paul and Silas's preaching at the synagogue at Berea resulted in both Jews and Gentiles coming to faith, God-fearing Gentiles coming to faith. But here it's very distinctly different. It's not some of them, but many of them. Many of them, because they were willing to entertain Paul's preaching. But they didn't accept it lock, stock, and barrel. They went back and they examined the scriptures to say if it was true. The Berean Jews did not accept any newfangled ideas, but they were willing to consider Paul's preaching. And therefore, they examined the scriptures to verify. They were open and they were receptive. And I think we as a church could learn from the Bereans that when we hear something that might sound new to our ears, we should not receive everything lock, stock, and barrel without examination. But we should go back to Scripture and examine it to ask ourselves the question, is this biblical? Is this in line with Scripture? And not be like the Thessalonian Jews and reject it outright without examining Scripture. Well, let's talk about the Athenians. You got the Thessalonian Jews, you had the Berean Jews, and we come to Athens. When Paul then went to Athens after the Thessalonian Jews went to Berea and stirred up a ruckus there, so Paul and Silas now went on. And Paul ended up in Athens. So what about the Athenians? Well, the text tells us that Paul went to Athens, and he did the same thing. He would go to the synagogue. But Athens being a largely Greek city, or Gentile city, he also went to the marketplace. You know, he set up a soapbox on the street corner, he stood up on it, and he spoke. And anyone who came up to him and engaged him, he would talk. And it tells us in verse 18 of chapter 17, a group of Epicurean and Stoic philosophers. If you don't know what an Epicurean is or a Stoic, it doesn't matter. The imperative word there is philosophers. These were smart guys. Used a lot of words, long words. They began to debate with Paul. They engaged him. And then in verse 19, it says that they took him and they brought him to a meeting of the Areopagus, which is like a council which kind of had some judicial authority over the city, where they said to him, hey, may we know what this new teaching is that you are presenting? Because you are bringing some strange ideas to our ears, and we'd like to know what they mean. Now, verse 21 is kind of interesting. This is a little parenthesis that Luke puts in there to help us understand the Athenians. He says, all the Athenians and the foreigners who live there spend their time doing nothing but talking about and listening to the latest ideas. I can imagine the coffee shop. Okay, uncle, all of us drinking their tea for a very long time, cold tea and chit-chatting, talk. Okay, Pastor Dan always say, no, can talk about potatoes and, man, these guys loved new ideas. It probably is like the TED Talk, okay, of the first century. These were the Athenians. People who loved new ideas, people who had many, many gods. In fact, that's how it's described. When Paul arrived at Athens, he says he was greatly distressed. He walked through the city, and he saw many, many idols. Now, it's reputed. I can't verify it, okay? But it's reputed there are something like 30,000 altars. Now, Athens, I don't think is that big. 30,000 altars. Man, that's a lot. And Athens was supposed to be a center of learning and intellectualism and all the kind. It's like a university town. So imagine if you go to Oxford today, and then, wow, in this great halls of learning, all these PhDs and, you know, all the Einsteins and the Newtons came from these places. And you walk and went to Oxford and say, hey, red shrine here. Hey, another red shrine. Oi, under this tree, got something there also, some joysticks sticking up. Then, what, everywhere. You think, what's going on? This is so all these intellects and yet all this stuff. Now, of course, Paul was not only upset because all these intellectuals put up with such things. He wasn't. He was upset because he was a Jew. And you must understand the mindset of a Jew. For a Jew, idolatry is a great, great sin. Commandment number 3, I think. Commandment number 3, you shall not make any graven images of me. For a Jew, an idol is an abomination. So when Paul arrives at Athens and is surrounded by idols, he was greatly distressed. That these people who were so, as it were, so longing to appease whatever gods there were out there, and yet so blind. So he was very distressed, that's the word, very vexed in his spirit. That's the context. And what Paul is preaching, there was this intellectual crowd that wanted to engage him. So you have a very strange place, a deeply, you could say deeply religious slash, some people would say superstitious, populous, and at the same time, a very intellectual crowd in the city of Athens. So they loved new ideas. They loved and enjoyed critiquing new ideas. But they weren't too, I'm not so sure they were keen on truth itself. I hope that doesn't describe any of us or anyone here that comes to DUMC. The pulpit is not something to be critiqued and just to be entertained. And it's, the Word of God is shared from here. It is not just to be, wow, good, interesting, very good, very good. Can you critique? Hey, not good, bad, lousy preacher with strange ideas. Cheh. The pulpit is for the communication of the Word of God. And we would receive the pulpit to take it home and examine whether it is scriptural. So therefore, if it's a new idea, we need to ask the question, is it scriptural? We shouldn't be so excited, wow, it's a new idea. Yes, I'm still tired of hearing everything, the same thing every week. Oh, wow, new thoughts. The pulpit is not for novelty. The pulpit is for the preaching of the Word of God, which stands the ravages of time. You know, the Thessalonians, I wonder if perhaps any of us here might be like the Thessalonian Jews. That we like what we've heard so far in the past, we've liked our church ways. When we hear something new, we reject it outright without considering it. If that were the case with DUMC 20-odd years ago, today we would not have the move of this Holy Spirit in DUMC. Because Pastor Daniel and the elders at that time were willing to consider the power and the work of the Holy Spirit today and therefore examine Scripture to see, hey, what these charismatics are saying, is it true? Is it biblical? And I thank God that we have elders like that who are prepared to be like the Bereans and say, hey, this is new to our ears. We're not exactly comfortable with it, but we want to examine the Scripture. Is it biblical? And I pray that we will be like that as a church, that we will be prepared to examine everything that we hear, whether from this pulpit or whether in what we read or whether we watch on the YouTube sermons that we hear or watch, that we're prepared to ask the question, is it biblical? The big idea again is that the gospel of Christ is for all humanity to hear. Therefore, all humanity, different kinds, whether in our society, whether they be Muslims, Hindus, Sikhs, Buddhists, Taoists, atheists, agnostics, confused, nominal Christians, churchgoers, the gospel of Christ is for all humanity to hear, and we need to communicate the gospel so that it can get a fair hearing. And let me tell you, a fair hearing is not, and it's far more than Jesus loves you on a bumper sticker or on a t-shirt. A fair hearing of the gospel requires that the gospel be communicated, the truths of the gospel be communicated clearly. So I talked about the crowds of people, the Thessalonians, the Bereans, and the Athenians. So how about Paul's communication posture? What was his attitude toward the people, and how did he then express that in his communications? You know, the gospel, because it's so important, it deserves a decent telling in order that people might hear what we are trying to tell them. It is not only enough that we want to tell them, it is necessary for us to tell them in such a way that they hear us. Therefore, we need to pay attention to how we may need to communicate the gospel. And Paul gives us a lesson here by firstly learning to be polite. Learning to be polite. Because it tells us in Acts chapter 17, verse 22, here in this city was full of idols, which I'm sure for Paul is like, first of all, this is so wrong. But for a crowd that's so intellectual, he's probably wondering, why can't you figure out this is so wrong to have so many gods? But instead, he stands up and says, people of Athens, addressing the Areopagus, this council, he says, I see that in every way you are very religious. You could say that that's a compliment, sort of. At the very least, it's an observation. You can't miss it, right? I mean, you know, you're in a place, you know, it's like you go to Bangkok, you can't miss it, right? You have golden spires everywhere, domes, you know, you go to some other places. Oh, in this place, 30,000 altars In essence, he said, I figure that you are very religious. Paul paid them a compliment. I see that you are really keen on at least trying to please or appease the gods, as far as you understand. First words matter. How we first say something matters. If Paul had started with, "You pagans, you pretend intellectuals, for all your intellectualism, you're a bunch of idiots." If Paul had started that way, it's like, "You idolatrous lot, you're going to hell. You should be so thankful that I'm here to tell you about Jesus so that you can all go to heaven." Now, if Paul had started that way, they would probably have quartered him and, he wouldn't have gotten very far. The reality is you cannot insult somebody into the kingdom of God. You cannot insult somebody into the kingdom of God. You can't ridicule someone into accepting the gospel of Jesus Christ. It doesn't work that way. Peter tells us, he says, "Hey, always be prepared to give an answer to everyone who asks you to give a reason for the hope that you have." In other words, hey, always be ready to share. Always. But it says, but. It's almost as if the emphasis is on the but. But please, please, please do it with gentleness and respect. Do it with gentleness and respect. Respect and honor the other person. I remember one time after coming out from this evangelism training, freshly minted, I memorized my gospel presentation. I was raring to go, and there was this, unsuspecting victim after church. Aha! I said, "Oh, okay." And I said, "Hi, what's your name?" And then, started. After 5 minutes, he said, "Okay." Then after another 15 minutes, he had no chance to say anything whatsoever. I just wanted to finish my presentation. "So do you want to accept Jesus?" I don't remember his answer. But I think it was probably, let me think about it. I did not respect him as a person. I didn't give him a chance to say anything. I didn't bother to listen to him. He was just a target for me. I think we would learn to be polite, respectful, courteous, to understand that everyone comes from a certain place. Some may need greater nurturing. Some we may need to hear them out a lot more. But we need to respect the individual. And when Paul stood up with this council of intellectuals, as it were, he first paid a compliment to them. He didn't say that they were dumb or stupid or idolatrous. He just said, "Well, you're a religious lot." How do we communicate with our friends? Whether in our communicating the gospel, how do we interact with them? Do we respect them? Especially when they have a faith, beliefs and faith system which is quite contrary to ours. And perhaps in the question in these days, with what's going on in our country, perhaps the question of religion comes up a little bit more often than it used to. What is our posture toward them? Are we choosing to be abrasive? Or are we choosing to be courteous? We could learn from Paul to be polite, to be courteous, to be respectful, just as Peter tells us to do. To share the gospel of Christ, to share the reason for our hope with gentleness and respect. The early church, I think, got it really, really right. Because they lived their lives and they lived the gospel in their communities in such a way, according to Acts chapter 2, verse 47, they had favor with the people. In other words, people found them, these Christians are quite good. I kind of like them. They are good neighbors. Not bad. Interesting. Very good. They had favor with the people. I think the question we should ask ourselves regularly is that how our neighbors feel about us? Is that how our friends think about us? Is that how our family thinks about us? If we would learn to be winsome in our approach, if we would learn to be respectful for the sake of Christ, that perhaps that we would have that set of us, that we have favor with our employer, with our colleagues, with our friends, with our fellow students. Learn to be polite. We can also learn from Paul to be plugged in. When I say plugged in, what I mean is to be plugged into the culture and of our neighbors. In order to do this, we need to seek to understand the worldview of others, how different people see the world very differently. You know, I deeply appreciate my colleagues who do community work. Because of their constant interaction with people from the lower strata of society, they are able to appreciate where these people are at and where they are coming from and why they might behave in the way that we behave. Whereas I, from where I'm at, might not be able to understand why they cannot simply just keep tidy. Why can't you eat without making a mess? And why do you have to dress so untidily? Because if I don't understand the world from which they come, then I will not understand why they behave the way they do. Learning to be plugged in into other people's worlds. You know, learning to be plugged into where people are at requires that we observe, that we listen, that we pay attention to people, to perhaps what they are saying. We ought to give them a hearing, not an earful. There was a story of an old man who one day was casually walking down a country road with his dog and his mule. And suddenly there was a pickup truck that came around the corner, speeding around, and ran out of control and careened and crashed into this old man with his dog and mule. And they threw them into the ditch. Well, the old man later decided he was going to sue the driver of the speeding truck. So in court, when the old man was at the stand about to, you know, he was being cross-examined by the defense lawyer, the lawyer for the truck driver. So the defense lawyer got up and challenged the old man. So, sir, I want you to answer this question with a yes or a no. That at the time of the accident, you told my client that you were fine. Well, the old man replied, well, me and my dog and my mule were walking down the road, and the defense lawyer said, no, stop. I said, would you please answer the question yes or no, that at the time of the incident that you told my client that you were perfectly fine. So the old man started again. He said, well, me and my dog and my mule were walking down the road, and the defense lawyer, stop, Your Honor, will you please tell this gentleman to please answer my question directly? Well, the judge says, well, I think he's trying to say something. Let's give him a hearing. Okay, so proceed. Well, the old man proceeded. He said, well, me and my dog and my mule were walking down this country road, and this truck came around the corner far too fast, and he knocked us into the ditch. The driver stopped, and he got out his truck. He saw that my dog was badly injured. He went back to his truck, took out his rifle, came back and shot the dog. Then he walked over and saw my mule, which was badly injured too. And he went, and he came over to me and he looked at me, how are you? He said, I'm perfectly fine. You had to give someone a fair hearing, not an earful. In order for us to be plugged into where people are at, we need to hear them. Communicating the gospel is not just about us telling them, it's about us listening to them as well. To our friends, to our neighbors of a different faith tradition, it's about us also listening and listening to understand. When Paul dealt with cultures that are different from his Jewish culture, he was not only polite, but he was plugged in. Why do we say that? Because in Acts chapter 17, verse 23, it says, "As I walked around and looked carefully at your objects of worship, I even found an altar with this inscription, 'To an unknown God.'" What did he say? He said, "I walked around your city and I looked carefully at your objects of worship." Now, for a Jew, you wouldn't want to do that, because a Jew would abhor idols. But he did that with a purpose, because he needed to understand where these Athenians were at. He says, "I looked at your objects of worship carefully." He studied their culture. He tried to understand their religious backgrounds. He tried to understand their worldviews, their philosophies. Why were they thinking and behaving this way? Paul made that effort. He wanted it plugged in to where the people of Athens was at. He took time to know the people. I don't know, maybe he went and sat down at a cafe in Athens and drank espresso, you know, to talk and listen to, you know, why, wow, you guys are really, really religious. Why, there's an altar here next week, got another one, a lot, huh? I don't know, maybe he did that. But he took time. He took time to try to understand. He expressed an interest in these people. And because of that, he found a natural point of contact from which there was an opening for him to share the gospel. And that's in the latter part of this verse. It says, "I've even found an altar with an inscription that said, 'To an unknown God.'" Now, there's a background to this. Apparently, quite a couple of centuries before that, Athens was hit by a plague when people were dying left, right, and center. And so the Athenians were offering up sacrifices and offerings to all their gods that they are known at that time, the named gods. So, but the plague went on. So they thought, oh yeah, how? So they got a consultant coming from Cyprus, and the consultant say, "Maybe it's one of the gods you haven't named that is responsible for this, and maybe if we appease him, we do not know who, they will take care of the problem." Says, how? You don't know? So he said, good question. So what he came up with was that he said, "We got a flock of sheep, some black sheep, some white sheep. I don't know why. We said some black sheep, some white sheep. Make sure they're hungry. Tomorrow morning we'll let them out, okay, to the fields. We'll let them out to the fields, and wherever any of these sheep lay down, we will slaughter the sheep there, make an offering, build an altar there, okay? Now, because it's very improbable for a hungry sheep to lie down, because hungry sheep will go and graze and eat." So they said, interesting. So that's what they did. So they let the sheep out, and wherever a sheep laid down, they would make an altar, they would slaughter the sheep, make an offering. So that's how, and within a couple of weeks, or within a week of that happening, the plague stopped. They said, one of these unknown, there were not only one, yeah? So there were quite a lot of these altars with inscriptions to an unknown god. So they said, wow, probably one of these unknown gods to us accepted our offering and, well, stopped the plague. So that's the background. And Paul probably heard about this, read about this, asked questions about this, he learned about this. See, Paul learned a lot of stuff, I think. He's not just an Old Testament scholar, a Bible scholar, but I think he was a great student of culture. And he was learning wherever he went. And we can tell from his writings, this guy got quite a lot of intellectual power, lah. Okay, smart dude, right? But he was learning. You know, do you know that Pastor Daniel is an engineer, actually? He's an engineer. He's an engineer by training. He did some theology as well. But Pastor Daniel knows a lot more than engineering and theology. And how does he do that? How did he do that? He did that by reading. Pastor Daniel is a voracious reader. He reads volumes. That's how he learned many, many things. He is perhaps like a Paul. Not only theology, not only his technical training in engineering, but he learns a little bit of economics. He tried to understand politics. He tried to understand other religions and Islam. He learned all this for the sake of the gospel, so that he could present the gospel more clearly, more relevantly to anyone that he might encounter. Pastor Daniel is always challenging us, the pastoral team, you know, you all read more, we'll be more widely read, you know, read everything you can get your hands on, sociology, psychology, philosophy, all the fees lah. Are we learning? Are we learning from our friends? Are we listening to them? And sometimes the only way to learn is to actually just simply interact with them, spend time with them. You know, at one time, this is ancient history, at one time, I was in charge of a Chinese church. Okay, me, a banana, cannot speak a word of Mandarin, was in charge of a Chinese church, a mainland Chinese church. Okay, these are all mainland Chinese. So through a broken English, we communicate, and sign language perhaps as well. And I discovered that because these mainland Chinese came from an atheistic background, a communist background, they did a completely different worldview from mine. And it was tough to try and understand where they were coming from. Very different from the mainland Chinese of today. Very different. But I learned a lesson there, that you need to understand where people come from before you can communicate effectively with them. So are we plugged into our friends, to their world? Are we plugged in into their faith systems? Do we understand? Perhaps we need to. Many of us live among Buddhists and Taoists and Muslims and Hindus. It would be very hard for us to share anything about our faith with them really until we know how they would receive that. You can talk to a Hindu about Jesus. He will welcome, oh, very good. I'll just add him to my pantheon of gods. And we must understand that in speaking to a Hindu, we cannot just present Jesus as a god. We have to present him as Jesus Christ, the God of gods. Understanding, getting plugged in to where people are at. I'd like to share with you a passage I read this week from Ajit Fernando. He's come to this pulpit before, and he's preached here before. And Ajit Fernando is one of the pioneering leaders of Youth for Christ in India. And this is what he wrote about his early days in Youth for Christ. He said, when we made a conscious decision in our ministry to focus on non-Christian youths rather than on nominal Christians, so Christians in churches, we found ourselves ill-equipped for the task. Thus, we began to study the Buddhist, Hindu, and Muslim cultures. We realized that though youth could be effectively reached through drama and music, which is still true today, our styles of drama and music were different from theirs. We therefore sent our staff to learn these art forms from non-Christians. And then we began to write our own music, and we began to write our own stage plays. We stopped using the games we played, which the non-Christians did not enjoy. Instead, we learned new games that they enjoy. We went to political meetings, especially when good orators were speaking. Why? So that we could learn their art of oratory, the art of speaking, public speaking. We were uncomfortable with some of these things, and I think all of us can understand that, how we would be uncomfortable learning new forms of expression. And during the early years, we would have liked to do ministry differently. But gradually, our ministry was Youth for Christ, was transformed into one that began to reach large numbers of non-Christian youths for Christ. Since then, we have had to keep changing our methods because the youth culture has kept changing. And learning to be plugged in this context for us here in DUMC requires that we keep changing our methods of communicating with the next generations. When I was a young person, we were singing scripture in songs, you know, three chord songs. We were playing silly games. But today the youth are completely different. You play a three chord song, they'll be bored stiff. You play the games that I played when I was a youth, they'll be bored stiff. Because youth culture has changed. And we need to change our methods to reach the next generations. And that's why in these coming years, when we reposition our church and our ministries so that we reach all the generations within our church, we need to rethink of how we do ministry to our young people. And it will be uncomfortable. And we will make mistakes along the way. But it is something that we cannot not do, because we need to be plugged in if we expect to reach the next generations out there, outside of the church. Oh, actually, you need to reach the ones inside the church as well. We need to learn to be plugged in. And it means that we will need to stop and expect everyone to have the same views as us. It will require us to listen to the young people around us and understand where they are coming from. It doesn't mean that they are right, but it does mean that we need to understand where they are coming from. We need to do that for the sake of the gospel. Besides, for us to learn to be polite, courteous, and respectful, we need to learn to be plugged in, to understand cultures of our time, the cultures of our youth, the cultures of our neighbors, their religious backgrounds. And how do we need to do that? Perhaps we need to spend time with them. Perhaps we need to learn about their cultures. But beyond that, we could learn from Paul. Do we learn to be persuasive? Persuasive. How do we be persuasive? You can't be persuasive unless you know what you are trying to say. Therefore, in order for us to be persuasive, we need to know and understand what we believe in order that we can explain it to someone else. You know, I remember one time I was in a car with a friend of mine, both partners in ministry, and we were talking. He was a PhD candidate and I was a master student. We were talking, and he said, "No, we should make things simple." I said, "Yeah, of course." It's really good to make things simple, but man, it's really hard to make things simple, because if you don't understand something, you cannot make it simple for someone else. Therefore, if we are going to be persuasive with the gospel, we need to understand and know what it is that we are trying to communicate. In Acts chapter 17, verse 2 and 3, it says that Paul, as was his custom, went to the synagogue, and there he was preaching and teaching for three Saturdays. He reasoned with them from the scriptures. He explained and proved that Christ had to suffer and rise from the dead. It says that he reasoned with them, he explained, he proved. A lot of work. Because reasoning requires dialoguing. Not only him talking, it required him to listen to what these guys were saying back to him. You know, when I used to teach, I used to lecture and tutor. But I love tutoring far more than lecturing. So please forgive me, I prefer a small group in which I can talk to people and listen to them and dialogue back and forth than this. Not that I don't appreciate you guys and all this, But I love it when I can sit around a table and we share things with other people and we talk about it and I try to share understanding and listen to where people say, I think you don't understand what I'm trying to say. And there's a dialogue back and forth. And this is what Paul was doing. Now, it's a great deal of effort. I used to tell my friends, and Pastor Gilbert found this out very true. When you teach for 4 hours, you are mentally drained. And that's what I learned in teaching. When I teach for 4 hours straight, I'm mentally drained. I'm dead for the day. Because it's hard work. Because it's hard work not only trying to say something, because in trying to be persuasive, I had to learn to listen as well. Paul opened up, he explained, tried to make things simple. He was trying to prove, show from the New Testament, proof after proof, that Jesus was the Christ. That's Paul, but how do we do that? In order for us to do that, like I said, we must understand our own faith. You know, while I agree that our experience of God and Christ, our experience is very important, because our experience needs to be a living experience, an everyday experience. But experience alone is not enough for us to share the gospel of Jesus Christ with someone. We need to understand the gospel. We need to be able to explain to someone, why is it that Jesus had to die? Why did he have to die on the cross? Why couldn't he just have been a good man and told us, hey, this is the way to God, just do this, and do this? Or just believe in me. Why did he have to die? Why is it in the church that we insist that our God is triune? Why do we insist that Jesus had to be fully man and yet fully God? Because these questions will come and these questions will arise, especially in the minds of a Muslim. Now, how do we grow in this in order we might be persuasive? We need to learn. We need to learn. We can't stop learning. And I hope that all of us, that after school, we have not turned off the learning mode. That as Christians today, in seeking to bear witness to Christ, that we continue to be learning. Let me give a plug for Equip. Please sign up Evangelism 101, okay? This is a commercial break. Right, please sign up for Evangelism 101, which is happening on November the 28th, because there you learn to be able to just share a simple presentation of the gospel with someone. Sign up for Basic Christianity 101, where you learn the simplest truths of Christianity. You know, there was a department store, and in all department stores, large stores, they always have a purchasing department, which organizes what they buy in order that to sell at their stores. And at this office of this purchasing department of this departmental store, there was a big sign that said, that was presented to all the salesmen who came there to try and sell their goods to be put in this store. It says, "Salesman, before you try to sell your product to us, be so convinced of its superiority that when you are finished, we will be more anxious to buy than you are to sell." In other words, if you're not convinced of the product you're trying to sell, then fat hopes on you selling it. And it would be true of the gospel of Jesus Christ. And when we're presenting the gospel of Jesus Christ to others, if we are not convinced of the power of the gospel to change lives and save people, our presentation will be weak. It's only when we know that the gospel, Jesus is the only way, you have to hear this, and I have to try and communicate this as clearly as I can. When we are convinced of the power of the gospel, and we're convinced of the need of the gospel and the truth of the gospel, then we are able to share it convincingly, persuasively with others. We need to learn to be polite. We need to learn to be plugged in. We need to learn to be persuasive. But very quickly, we need to learn to be purposeful. That in all our conversations, that while not all conversations may come to that point where we can ask someone, would you like to accept the Lord Jesus Christ? Not all of our conversations will come to that point. But our conversations need to recognize that people ultimately need Jesus Christ. They don't need good advice, just. Sometimes people do need good advice. People need encouragement. Yes, but ultimately, people need the Lord. I'm about to break into song. Ultimately, people need the Lord. So in our conversations, we need to be purposeful. We see that how purposeful Paul is, because two lines in this Luke summary, Paul comes to say, I'm about here to proclaim to you who this unknown God is. That's all he wanted to do. He wasn't there to discuss philosophy or theology with these guys. He was there to proclaim this God to them. And he carries on very quickly. He says, this God has overlooked ignorance in the past, but now he commands all people everywhere to repent. He cut to the chase. He says, you guys have been idolatrous. You don't know it. But let me tell you very clearly, there is only one God, and this God is nearby. He commands you to repent. He got to the point very quickly. He was purposeful. And in the end, what he really wanted to present was to present Christ, which brings me soon to the last point. But once again, the big idea. Really, the gospel of Christ is for all humanity to hear. And because of that, we need to communicate the gospel so that it can get a fair hearing. Learn to be polite, learn to be plugged in, learn to be persuasive, learn to be purposeful. But how did Paul present Christ? This was the thing that he was aiming for to share. And how did he present Christ? You know, we must not miss the point of the gospel. Ultimately, it's about Christ crucified on our behalf. for our sins, to reconcile us to a holy God. And His resurrection is proof that that objective was met, that the Father accepted that sacrifice and made it efficacious for us. You know, as Christians, becoming a Christian, we've had many, many blessings and many, many benefits. We've had the benefit of becoming a part of a large family of believers in which we learn to bear one another's burdens. We suddenly become a part of a community where we learn to love one another, accept each other. That's a blessing. And some of us really have enjoyed the blessing of God answering our prayers in many, many ways, healing us perhaps, providing for us. But you know, Jesus did not come to feed the 5,000. Jesus did not come to heal the sick. We did do that. He did feed the 5,000. He did heal the sick. But Jesus came to die on the cross. That was His goal. That was His purpose. Along the way to proclaim the kingdom of God, He healed people. He fed the hungry. He made the blind man see. The heart of the gospel is not the blessings that come from knowing Christ. The heart of the gospel is that Christ was crucified on our behalf. That if I should not even have a prayer answered for me, that if I should die of a sickness for which I cried to God every day that He would heal me from, even if that should happen, the gospel says, I am saved. And that's all that really matters. The gospel of Christ is about Christ crucified on our behalf so that we could be reconciled back to God. Because that is the single most important thing, our destiny in eternity. And when Paul went into this, he went into every place, this is what he presented. He presented the cross of Jesus Christ. He presented the resurrected Christ. He presented the Christ who had to die. He was persuading the Jews at Thessalonica that this Messiah had to die. He had to suffer and had to die. But this Messiah in Jesus Christ rose from the dead, and why and what that meant. Paul was purposeful to present Jesus Christ as the Messiah, the crucified and resurrected Messiah. In Acts chapter 17, he even said this in Athens, because he was preaching about Jesus and the resurrection. And this idea of the resurrection was perplexing to the Athenians. In fact, at the end of his sermon in Acts chapter 17, when he mentioned, it says there in verse 31, when he says, he has given proof of this to everyone by raising him from the dead. And said, when they, the Athenians, heard about the resurrection of the dead, some of them sneered. They didn't like that part. They thought, this is hogwash. This is nonsense. But Paul nevertheless said it, because that was the point that he needed to get to. That was the gospel he needed to present. And Paul was very clear. This is what I preach. In 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 22 and 23, he says, the Jews demand signs, the Greeks look for wisdom, but we preach Christ crucified. The Jews don't like it. It's a stumbling block to them. To the Gentiles, it's nonsense. It's foolishness. But nevertheless, we preach Christ crucified, because only in Christ crucified is their hope. So therefore, we preach Christ crucified. And in our sharing of the gospel with our friends, may we go beyond answered prayers. May we go beyond material blessings of being one with Christ. And may we get to the point where we need to tell them, you need more than the blessings of answered prayer. You need Christ in your life. We need Christ. And I pray that as God gives us opportunity, that we would be able to speak wisely, politely, persuasively, courageously, boldly for Christ. That we would be able to tell people about His death so that they will understand that Jesus died in their place and that they can be forgiven for all their sins. And that we will be able to tell them about the resurrection so that they can have a hope beyond death. And I pray that we will be able to tell our friends and our neighbors and our colleagues about the love and the peace and the joy that will be theirs once they surrender to Christ. We need to present the cross and the resurrected Christ to our friends. Ultimately, for all everything else that we may share of the good things that God has been to us, we need to share the resurrected Christ with them. And we need to do it being polite, plugged in, persuasive, and very clearly purposed to sharing the gospel of Christ. The big idea, once again, that the gospel of Christ is for all humanity, from all strata of society, from all ethnic groups, from all religious backgrounds. We need to communicate the gospel so that it can get a fair hearing. You know, there's a story of a woman who was driving in her car down the street. It was a hot day, so she wound the windows down. And she stopped at the stoplight, and there was another car that came next to her, and the windows were also down. There was a man sitting in the car, and he was looking at her, grinning. This old lady was wondering, why is this man so nice, smiling at me all the time? So as the lights turned green, they both moved off. And suddenly, this old lady discovered that this man threw something across from his car into her car through an open window. She thought, how rude. It was a crumpled piece of paper. So finally, when she got to where she was, and she stopped, and she picked up the crumpled piece of paper, and she opened it up and said, it was a gospel tract. Jesus loves you. Now, I hope that's not the way we share the gospel. Because the gospel is not advanced in that way. The gospel is advanced through us giving people a fair opportunity to hear the gospel clearly. And we as messengers of Christ need to know our message well so that when we share it, we can be persuasive. That we need to be messengers and ambassadors of Christ, bearing the name of Christ proudly. That when we share, we'll share politely. That we understand where our hearer and listener is at. Because the gospel is so valuable, we cannot afford to treat it as something that can simply be put on a bumper sticker or a t-shirt or a crumpled tract. The gospel is valuable enough for us to share it carefully and to make sure that it gets a fair hearing in the ears of our audiences. Shall we pray? You know, if you've been in DUMC long enough, you know that one of the things that we are constantly challenged from this pulpit from is to be witnesses for Jesus Christ. And we all know that Pastor Daniel is the foremost advocate of this. But can I remind us all, it is not Pastor Daniel's expectation of us. It's the Lord Jesus Christ's expectation of us as His disciples. That we are to be witnesses for Him. It is a mandate of Christ for the church to be preaching the gospel to the ends of the earth. So no matter how ill-equipped we feel we are, no matter how ill-prepared we feel we are, the mandate does not change. We, the Church of Jesus Christ, at least definitely here in Damansara Utama Methodist Church, we need to remember that we've been commanded to take the good news to others. And my challenge today for all of us here in DUMC is that we may recommit ourselves to that mandate. That we recommit ourselves to that great commission that Jesus gave us. to preach good news and to make disciples. Will we respond to recommit ourselves consciously to say, Lord, I may not be good at this, but I recognize I need to share the good news of Christ with others. Will we as a church do that? And if you're a member of DUMC, will you, as part of DUMC, commit to do that? If you will you stand? As an encouragement not only to each other, but as a commitment before the Lord to say, Lord, help me. Because we all need grace. And the Bible tells me that the Holy Spirit has been given to us so that we may be good witnesses for Christ. So we are empowered to do so. But we need to be the one to say, yes, I will. So will you stand and will you make the commitment to be a witness for Christ? It doesn't mean that you're going to be an evangelist. No. Some of you are. But it simply means I need to learn to share the good thing of the gospel of Christ with the people around me. Will you commit to that? Father, we stand before you. Lord, and we acknowledge our weakness. And we acknowledge our inadequacies. And there is much for us to grow and learn. But Father, we thank you for your grace. And most of all, we thank you for your Holy Spirit in us, who empowers us to be witnesses for Jesus Christ. So Father, as we stand and commit ourselves to being witnesses to our friends, our family, our neighbors, our colleagues, that we would be polite, that we would learn to be understanding of where they are at, that we would learn to be persuasive, and that we would be Christ-centered in the direction of our conversations. Lord, we thank you for your Holy Spirit who helps us to do this. So Lord, as we commit ourselves to this task and this mandate of bearing witness for Christ, Lord, use us and grant us opportunities that we may grow in this as witnesses, that our fears may be overcome, that our words may become more persuasive, that our understanding of the gospel may increase. So Lord, as we avail ourselves to respond to you, use us, deploy us for the sake of the gospel. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. We're going to sing, and after that, I'll make a few more challenges. Lord, we commit ourselves to you once again. Lord, by our living and by our speaking, may we honor you.
Lord, with all my heart, I worship you.
Oh,
We want to encourage all of you. The Bible tells us that every member in the body of Christ has been given gifts. And these gifts have been given for the edification of the church, for the advancement of the kingdom, for the doing of the ministry of the church of Jesus Christ. And some of you God has given an incredible gift of evangelism. Some of you God has given you the gift of an evangelist. You just are able to connect with people. But when you speak, people listen to you. You are able to share the gospel of Jesus Christ with them. If God has given you that gift, we want to encourage you to exercise those gifts. We want to pray for you that you will grow in that gift, that the gospel of Jesus Christ will be shed more and more through you. And so if you have been given that gift, can I encourage you, or you think you have been given that gift, or you want to have that gift, I want to encourage you and ask you to come forward because we want to pray for you. We want to pray that you will grow. We want to pray that you will be released in that gift of an evangelist. If you have that gift, could I ask you to come forward now so that we can pray for you? There are others of us, you know, we struggle in anything that we do in following Christ. We struggle because we are not yielded to Christ. And when it comes to sharing of the gospel, if we are not yielded to Christ, we are not yielded to the Holy Spirit, we cannot. We cannot. And we want to encourage you. We need to surrender to Jesus by His Spirit. We need to yield to the Holy Spirit. And some of you have not yet been baptized in the Spirit. If that is your longing, we invite you to come. Because increasingly we want to see as a church that we are a Spirit-filled church. That we are a church who go with the Holy Spirit, who accept and allows the Holy Spirit to work in our lives. So church, if it's you, come forward because we want to pray for you. And while you're doing that, I want to speak to those of you who are not Christians. You know, I've been talking about the gospel of Jesus Christ without actually saying too much about it. But the truth is, all of us, according to the Bible, say that we are sinners. And there's no way that we can come to God except through Jesus Christ. And Jesus was the one who laid down His life so that we can become friends once again with God. And if your heart says, hey, I really want to be at peace with God. How do I do this? How do I come and accept this work of Jesus? Very simple. You just trust in Jesus Christ. Trust in what He has done for you. And a simple expression of that trust is in a prayer. A prayer that says simply, sorry, thank you, please. A prayer in which you say, sorry, I've done things in my life that are very wrong. I have sinned in my life. Thank you for dying on the cross because of my sin, for my sin. Thank you for giving me an opportunity to be good again with God. Please come into my life and fill me with your Holy Spirit. Sorry, thank you, please. That's all it takes for you to express your trust in Christ. If that's what you want to do, you come forward too, and we'll be so glad just to be able to do that with you. Church, I want to challenge you. At this time, when we open the area in front for anyone who wants to be prayed for, you come. Whether you need healing in your life, whether you're in great difficulty financially, whether you're in a relationship crisis. The reason why we exist as a church and as a community together is so that we can encourage one another. So if you're in such a situation, let someone pray for you. Come forward, let someone here pray for you. Don't wait. Come forward while we sing the chorus a couple more times. So come forward if you want prayer. Someone will pray with you and for you.
Lord, I give you my heart. I give you my soul. I give you my soul.
teams, come forward, cell leaders. Would you please come forward and pray for these people? If you have any need for prayer, just come. Someone will pray with you. Let's pray. Father, we give thanks to you for your grace poured abundantly upon us, that we should be saved, that we should be called the children of God. Lord, what privilege we have. And Father, as we look to you, Lord, to empower us to be good witnesses of Christ to our friends, our neighbors, our colleagues, our families. Father, we thank you once again for your Holy Spirit in us. So Father, right now as we leave this place and go back to our respective homes, our respective workplaces, our offices, schools, colleges, universities, to our social spaces. Father, in all those places where we go, Father, we thank you that your Holy Spirit goes with us. And we pray, Lord, may your favor go with us into those places. Lord, that we go there with the aroma of Christ, that where we bear witness and bring glory to you. Lord, that others would be blessed by you because we, your people, are there. So Lord, grant us this greatest of blessings. Go with us to our homes and all the places that we go to. Glorify yourself, Lord, through us, we ask in Jesus' name. Amen.